I'd been at Tenwick for maybe 2 to 3 years, and things were quite busy. We only had two of us long-term surgeons. It was a Sunday afternoon, chance to be with my family after church and get some rest, and the phone rang. And it was the nurse in charge of the hospital covering that Sunday afternoon. And she said, "Dr. Chupp, I'm really sorry to bother you. I know you're not the doctor on call, but the police are here and they need to do an autopsy on one of the surgery patients who passed away a couple of days ago. And they really need that done today. The family's here, they need to take the body." And I politely responded, "Well, I'm not on call, and Dr. So-and-so is on call. Have you talked to him?" "Yes, we have, Dr. Chupp, but he's refusing to do it. He says he's too busy, he's tired, and he doesn't want to do this autopsy." "Well, this doctor actually has received a formal training on how to do autopsies by the Kenyan government, and it's just part of their agreement. They do autopsies." So I paged him, called him, and I said, "Dr. So-and-so, what's going on? What's the problem? Why can't you do the autopsy?" And make a long story short, he just basically refused to do the autopsy on this patient. Very frustrated, I trudged up the hill to the hospital, and I've had very little experience in doing autopsies, which probably led to what happened as I was doing the autopsy and opening the chest to take a look and try to figure out why this trauma patient had died. I slashed my finger, cut my finger through the gloves, and was immediately frustrated and upset about that. And I said, "Can I see the chart?" And I'd looked at the chart in a cursory fashion, but I hadn't looked through all the lab results. And that pink slip was there, and knowing it was an HIV test, I looked at it, and there was a positive result. And so my heart sank. I just got a sick feeling in my stomach. Finished the autopsy. I went home. I just plopped myself on my bed on that Sunday afternoon. I was looking up at the ceiling and was really, really down. Probably as down, my wife said, as she'd ever seen me, that this had happened. I'd gone up to do a procedure that I wasn't supposed to be covering, and then I had this complication. And I just asked, "Why, God? I mean, this doesn't make any sense. This isn't funny. What's this all about?" And after kind of brooding and feeling sorry for myself for a while, my wife came in and she knew I was down, and she said, "It's gonna be okay, honey, it's gonna be all right." And I said, "You know, how long do you think it would take us if we were to call tomorrow, Monday morning, and talk to our travel agent, how long do you think it would take before we can get everything together?" We had two small children at the time, before we could just get out of here and go home. Cause this is not fair, and I'm just tired of being here. And I was laying there for about 10 or 15 minutes and not feeling a whole lot better when, in the corner of the room, a phone rang. Now, for Americans, maybe think, "Well, what's the big deal? The phone rang." Well, this was one of two phones that we had in all of Tenwick that people from the outside could call in and get a hold of us. And it basically never, it almost never rang. So I went to the phone and I picked it up and answered it, and, "Hey, Mike, is that you?" And I said, "Yes, it is. This is Mike Chupp. Who's this?" And he said, "Well, this is Dr. Jim Teeter." And you know, I sprung open. "Dr. Teeter, amazing. How did you get through to me?" "Well, I contacted World Medical Mission and we found out the number there and heard you have a phone in your house. How are you doing?" And I briefly shared with him the story of what had happened that day, and it was just great to hear his voice. As a medical student and as a resident, Dr. Teeter had introduced me to missionary surgery. So here's one of my mentors that had introduced me to Tenwick Hospital and surgery, and he was on the phone, and I hadn't talked to him or heard from him for years. I just felt like I should call you this morning and tell you some good news. The Lord just seemed to put that on my heart. So I'm calling to tell you that we've heard you're really interested in orthopedic surgery, and we know from having been at Tenwick before, they don't have much equipment. We would like to make a donation of $5,000 to your ministry to help you buy orthopedic equipment and supplies." Oh, I couldn't believe it. I was stunned that someone I hadn't heard for years picks that particular moment as he's getting ready to head out to church to call me to tell me this news. And it came on the heels of a situation in which I was more discouraged than I had been ever and was thinking about leaving. And I just started to cry, and I'm sorry, Dr. Teeter, I'm getting kind of emotional because it's been a tough day, but you've picked an amazing time to call me. And I just went back and plopped on the bed, and I said, "God is real." He's out there. He has not forgotten us. I can't explain any other explanation the fact that this phone rang and Dr. Teeter called me today, other than God, he knows. He knows the burden on my heart today. Missionaries get discouraged, just like Christian workers in America get discouraged, but we're far away from family and facing sometimes what seem like insurmountable odds and just heavy patient loads. And encouragement like that from a mentor, a word of encouragement, a gift, any kind of support can really lift up a hurting missionary. And it's been said that over half of new missionaries these days are not making it past one term. And so I want to encourage CMDA members and their families and their churches just to keep on encouraging missionaries. It really makes a difference. And so I'm grateful to God that he doesn't forget about those servants who are out there on the front line serving overseas in difficult situations. And he knows what we need at the right time.